Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming out tonight. It's a real pleasure to be able to make the exhibition here at the Dunlop. I'm a kind of committed book person in my work. When it's not in the form of the book, often uses the structure of books or the culture of books as a kind of pivot point for the projects. Books can do lots of things, and I thought maybe the thing to do tonight would be to take you through some previous projects to give some context for the show upstairs. I wanted to sort of share this snapshot. It's a book on public speaking from the 1930s that is chained into the lectern in the big auditorium at Emily Carr in Vancouver. And it sort of starts to demonstrate ways that books can communicate without ever being able to read it. There's nothing worse than being nervous in front of an audience, stepping up and then having a 300-page book on skills of public speaking, which you clearly have no time to read. And reading books by their covers is something that I've always been quite interested in, like the physicality of the book and the kinds of things that it can say even before you pick it up and flip through the contents. And one of the earliest projects that's in the exhibition, its life started from this kind of relationship. It's a project called National Gallery Catalog, and it's a facsimile of a book. It's a catalog, actually, that was published by the National Gallery of Canada on the minimalist artist Donald Judd in 1975. There's a copy of the original there. Many years ago, I guess it's actually 16 ago now, I'd walked into a used bookstore in Toronto and had seen this quite striking object in the glass cabinet. It's quite a beautiful book. It's very thorough. And being a bit of a Judd fan myself, I thought that I would like to buy it. The bookseller at the store kind of looked at me strangely and sort of shrugged her shoulders and said, well, I guess it's credit card because it's $2,000. And sort of this weird thing had happened, that a book that was made for dissemination about an artist's work to be relatively affordable in its time, over the 20 years from when it was published, it became quite rare and kind of impossible to get. It's a book that now, this one here, is accessed in special collections in a library. And I remember walking home feeling a bit disappointed because I just really wanted to curl up and read that book. And something about the physicality of that book reminded me of the feeling of the package of paper when you go to load up the photocopier. And so I went to the studio, took a package of 500 sheets of 8.5 by 11 paper, glued it, and quickly made a hand-drawn copy. So it becomes like a decoy for the original. And it's a sculpture in a way that if you try to flip through it like a conventional book, it would fall apart. But still, in the book form, it's readable and has a function. It can kind of hold a place on a bookshelf for somebody who would like the Donald Judd book but can't quite afford it. These sorts of decoy books, or books that are read entirely by their covers, are things that I picked up in subsequent projects. A project I made in 2013 called Four Notable Booksellers was a sculptural construction based on the booksellers' cabinets that line the river in Paris. They're quite amazing things that have been there for at least a couple hundred years, right along the water. The cabinets open and close every day, and depending on whether the bookseller's in or not. And to this day, they're quite fascinating. There's a weird range of different booksellers. Some of them have a lot of kind of, you know, more things geared to tourists, old Pari Match magazines, and others. These sorts of small-scale bookstores, it really reveals their individual specializations. So you can walk along and it can be like Eiffel Tower keychains, or it can be a really rigorous presentation of French poetry next to one on photography magazines. And I quite liked that rhythm of getting a sense of who that bookseller was. So this work, imagine four different booksellers, each of which who had different specializations. I made every book in there was a facsimile. The covers were built on either collage or drawing to create the inventory for an individual bookseller. Quite like the way that that kind of constellation of books evoked a subject. It became kind of a bit of a ghost. Looking at each of the cabinets, maybe you would try to connect what those different titles might mean or who might have assembled them. This particular one was somebody who was quite interested in books about Oxford and Cambridge and code breaking. A more recent project happened in a show at Susan Hobbs Gallery last year. It's a project I called Volumes. I should disclose that before being represented by this gallery, I'd worked as an assistant director there more than a decade before. And looming over the desk where I worked was this enormous vertical bookshelf. And the bookshelf held the gallery's entire archives, books and catalogs by the artists they represented, all kinds of magazines that they'd subscribed to, books by artists that they didn't represent, but it became this like hugely looming presence. And in a way, it sort of spoke to the authority of the gallery structure itself. So my project was, we systematically removed all of the elements from the gallery's bookshelves and transposed them into neutral boxes and filled them in the space so that all of these individual volumes now spoke to this sort of large solid volume. And that kind of archive of the gallery became more a physical mass than one that you might peruse from the spines. The show's called The Booklover, and the term is, The Booklover was one that I linked to this particular image. Years ago in Berlin, I was flipping through one of those markets where the sellers have bins of old photographs, all loose. And you know, I don't know about you, but whenever I find one of these and I have a bit of time, I like to kind of sort through and see if you can start to kind of link up the photos. Now, it's not really about finding one that really speaks to you, but trying to see if you can connect the ones that are there. And I actually found two images of this individual posing on a couch with a book, and you can see both of them in they feature in works in the show. And I was always struck by her. I like the fact that she's sort of, it's a bit ambiguous if she's self-consciously posing as the author of a book, or the reader of the book, or both. And this image scanned sort of appeared in a number of projects. Probably, you know, most prominently was as the cover of a book that I made called The Booklover. This book was started in 2008, and at that moment, it seemed to be quite an exciting time for books in general, if you were sort of interested in books and seeking them out. Thinking back to that Donald Judd book that I showed you, it was sort of this moment where older books began to be, like, older bookstores used to put their, started putting their inventories online. Lots of other bookstores, commercial bookstores, have had full lists online. Publishers around the world, you could start ordering directly. So it seemed that the end of the book was not about to happen, which was seemed to be in sort of the popular discourse, but that actually there were more and more books available. And the last element that sort of started to come to the fore at the time was the advent of web-based print-on-demand technology. And I'd been invited to do, which for me was quite exciting, because unlike that Donald Judd book, where even if the National Gallery had printed 1,000 copies, which might have seemed like a ridiculous amount at the time, clearly was not enough. Print-on-demand meant that the book would never run out. It would never become scarce. It would always be available. Any person, to this day, can go online, lulu.com, and order a copy of The Booklover. And one of the things that I also found quite exciting about this was that as the author of a book on a service like Lulu, I had utter and complete control of the contents of that book. I could change the contents at any time. And I do. And so the book then starts to function more like a folder on your desktop where images get collected and added into the sequence of the book. Images like this, people posing with books, images like stills from films, like from this Godard film where the books are used to throw insults at each other. And also lots of both found images, like the one on the left. I mean, there really is nothing better than getting a sense of what someone else is reading. Or images that I've taken myself. And the image on the right is actually an image of the artist Kathy Slade from Vancouver. And she's looking at a copy of The Booklover, in which an image of her that I'd stolen at a New York art book fair of her reading The Booklover, I inserted it into the book, and the subsequent printing had an image of her in it, which she really hated the image that I'd selected, and so she subsequently had another person take this photo so that I could substitute it in the book. And I guess for me, this it becomes a sort of slippery thing, because when you have a copy of the Booklover, you don't know if you have a unique iteration of it, because there's no indicator of print run, edition number, any of these things. The only way to know if yours is unique is really to start to compare it to somebody else's copy. And in a way, that's quite true. All of us, every book that we have is a unique copy. You know, we all might be our copy of a novel that we've dropped in the bathtub immediately becomes a unique version. But also, as readers, I think we affect the book itself, like the way that for all of us, as we, even if we can in this room agree on a novel that we all maybe have read, I can guarantee in all likelihood that all of us would have read a different one first. And so this sort of trajectory of reading, or kind of reading paths, are quite unique. So each copy gets kind of experienced as if it is a unique thing anyway. And the Booklover book has also appeared in other forms. It's been translated into a series of pennant flags. This work features in the show upstairs, where various pages of the book have been output as on cotton shapes stitched together, and so the book becomes a public event. And I'll often in projects posit a sculpture as if it were a book. This one is probably the most direct, as is this other work, TK, which also is included in the show upstairs. TK is this sculptural accordion folded linen box, and at the moment it was initially shown, it was empty, and then the recipient will receive over the period of 1 year elements each week, each of them measuring 12 by 17 inches, and they, each element as it comes through the post like a postcard functions as the book appearing a page at a time. So the vessel precedes the content. And the act of publishing, I've always found quite thrilling. I mean, I'm a bookstore guy. My mom worked in the warehouse at the Scholastic Book Club growing up. I had worked in bookstores from the age of 16 to 35. And I've always been quite curious about what happens when you publish a book. I mean, there's this beautiful privilege where when you make anything in an edition, as the maker, you're often the only person who ever sees all of it at once. Whether it's all of the books on a shipping pallet or all of the prints recently, you know, editioned and stacked, it's quite a wonderful moment. And then as they distribute, each one will appear in a different spot. So in a book, it becomes a bookshelf. And sort of thinking about this kind of potential landscape, if we could imagine each book as a kind of plotted dot on a map, every time we hold a book, we can kind of imagine this map and try to imagine where every other copy comes from. I started thinking about it in terms of like Robert Smithson's writing on sites and non-sites, the way that there's this kind of connectedness between all copies, and each yours on its own is really only a fragment of this. It was really the starting point for this particular poster project I did with the Art Gallery of York University, which was a book called Robert Smithson that had an ISBN associated with it, 01992466. And the book, though, was one that happened spatially. It was 1,000 pages, and rather than being one that was sort of published for people to access, it was one that appeared using a professional postering company. It was distributed on the streets of Toronto in identical pages over a period of 6 weeks, one winter. And so the book became a temporal thing. It kind of vanished after a time, though it still appears on the Art Gallery of York University's website as an out-of-print title. And I admit, it sort of starts with a kind of punny, bad observation. When I type emails, I'm very hasty, and I often will clip words. And I've been writing, corresponding with somebody about the American land artist Robert Smithson, and I kept clipping the sun off and wrote an entire email about Robert Smith, who was, of course, the lead singer of The Cure. And I was teased a lot by the person I was communicating with, and then I decided that maybe there should be a connection and started to build an archive of images that might connect Robert Smith with Robert Smithson, which was perhaps, at the time, felt a bit too silly, so it only appeared as this poster, though in the show upstairs and subsequently is a second edition, which you can read. And this sort of distributive strategy was one that really strongly informed a project I developed for the power plant in Toronto from 2011 called Albatross Omnibus. And it both thought about what the strategy for the show was to make one a major kind of commission show that, you know, was temporal, that had a kind of installation impact, but that throughout the show would sort of dissolve and kind of get dispersed. And it was about also the physicality of reading. When you entered the gallery, you could choose to walk into the gallery on one side of this zigzagging wall, which is an enlarged accordion-fold book. On this side, there's images, alternating images of the book lover. And on the reverse was an opportunity to show my work on paper drawing series that I've been working on for the last 12 years. Accordion folds are quite wonderful because they're a book that's sort of halfway between scroll and codex. You can open an accordion fold and flip through it a page at a time, or you can fully expand it and look at it in its entirety. It's a book that whose architecture becomes really quite apparent. It's sort of flexible, and you as the reader have a lot of opportunity to manipulate it and determine the sequence. And I quite liked how, by making it architectural for the show, it also really reinforced the sort of physicality of reading, that it wasn't something that was like just a kind of cerebral thing, but something that was fully embodied. This became the most clear when you entered the central room, which, regardless of which side of the accordion wall you ended up in. And in this room were a series of Home Depot-style locking ladders, which one needed to use to maneuver around the gallery to access a grid of 52 books that were hovering above. The number 52, which seems quite magical now, you know, deck of cards, weeks in the year, was determined because that was the number of days the exhibition was open to the public. And I researched, designed, and produced one artist book title for each day of the show. And so each day when you came to the galleries in the bookshop, only one title would be available for sale. So it became the book that was the one that would kind of give you a sense of how to interpret the show for the day, or a bit like a McDonald's toy. If you wanted to kind of come through the galleries, and people did, you had to kind of maneuver the staircase under a book that you wanted to read, lock it down, and then climb up to the top and reach up to read. So you have to kind of perform your own readership. And for me, the 52 books really did tap me out of almost every idea I ever had for an artist book. So I ended up also relying a lot on the kind of perceived ideas of what artist books might be. And I thought I would show you a couple. There's 12 of them that are included in the show upstairs to give you a sampling of what the show is about. One like this one, Dodging Ulysses, was me finally finding a use for that copy of James Joyce's Ulysses I bought many years ago and never read, where an assistant who has a very good throwing arm would hurl it at me and I would get out of the way, and I did not get struck. So a number of them are kind of books that are structured around a kind of simple performative action. Other books like Ghent Cop Dance is one that really was about giving a kind of a new spin on an archive of images I'd already been collecting. I've had a lot of opportunities to go to Ghent, and it's quite a curious town in Belgium. And one of the things that's quite interesting about it is that it has a feral rooster problem, which sounds a little bit strange. The title, of course, sorry, also makes reference to a very famous artist book by Sol DeWitt called Cockfight Dance, which is a kind of photo sequence between two roosters about to have a standoff, and then it's peacefully interrupted by a cat. And in Ghent, there's this like feral rooster situation where every year at Easter, it's a common practice to give children a chick that's been dyed like a pastel color as a gift. And like any good hatchery, you hang on to the female chicks so that some of the male chicks that around Easter time get given as these gifts. And the ones that do make it to adulthood, you really don't, at the most you need one rooster in a city, not more than one. So they find themselves into the parks. And so the sequence of photos like this one were ones that I kind of captured, which in a way it's, I think all towns have some kind of creature that's, to everyone that lives there, it's totally normal, but when a tourist comes to town, a kind of freaks them out. Like in Toronto, you have black-furred squirrels that people seem to go a bit crazy for. I also, for when we go upstairs, there's some works in drawing, and I wanted to kind of give some background on my drawing practice to contextualize those projects upstairs. I mentioned earlier, I have a drawing practice project that's been ongoing probably for the last 12 years. They're a series of large format drawings. They're about a meter by a meter and a half, about the size of, you know, about a poster in the subway, you know, something that's kind of a bit bodily. And at the time I was really doing a lot of work with public postering, and I've always loved, you know, in particularly in transit systems, when there's a kind of structure that's designed to receive a poster, so that when you're on a daily commute, there's this kind of rhythm where there's a frame that is already open and ready to receive content. And if you take the same route every day, the posters will change accordingly, because they're only, of course, the spot is only sold for so long. And I quite liked the kind of contradictions that would start to happen. You might have start with an ad for shoes that would then get replaced by, you know, an ad for a charity that would then get replaced by, you know, some kind of beverage. And this kind of like contradictory sort of rhythm that would happen. And in that, I found the thought there was really great potential for a project where in the studio, it would allow me to change my forms. You know, work from you know, different subject matter, and in the logic of posters on the subway, it would kind of all start to make sense. The first presentation, this is an image from it, was in a group show in 2006 in Vancouver at the Contemporary Art Gallery, and at that moment we just also decided to kind of hang them all close together as if they were posters in the subway, so that you never really look at just one. And another thing started to happen with them. When they arrived in Vancouver, they all had numbers. It was just a practical thing for me to keep track. And I just thought that the title would be Standing on the Shoulder of Giants. And of course, the reference was kind of a insider music nerd thing. It was named after the British band Oasis's fourth record, which is thought to be, almost universally thought to be terrible. And that was at the point of, they were the most sort of drug-addled, and they were the super belligerent, and I think every person that worked for them hated them. And when they asked them what the name of the record would be, they said they wrote it down on a sheet of paper, and of course, shoulder should be plural, it should be shoulders. And nobody in their management, or their record company, or the graphic designer corrected it. So it was allowed to be this sort of mistake. And I quite liked this sort of how a single letter S could create a kind of slip. And Oasis was like, well, you know, we're just working class. Why would we know? It doesn't matter. You still get the sense. And it sort of also kind of was affected the way I was thinking about the compositions. I started with them thinking about moments where well-known artists had kind of claimed vernacular everyday forms. So the way that kind of, you know, certain sort of shapes would have a like a whiff of an artist that through their claim on it, could, you know, they kind of took it onto their authorship. And thinking about the that rhythm of posters, and it was sort of after that first show, I started to realize more what the project was about, which is kind of a nice thing. And I thought with the rhythm of the posters, but also that layering and changing of imagery could also start to happen with the titles. So immediately, the sort of logic of the series started with the image would be static, but that the title could accumulate like a poster in a subway. So the errant S was addressed as part of the title, so the previous iteration was crossed out. In a subsequent presentation of 2008, kind of an associative title happened. It was during the World Cup when the French football captain gave his famous headbutt, and somehow the red, white, and blue of this particular drawing seemed to make a lot of sense. Subsequently, the last iteration, My Tailor is Rich, came from conversations with people in France, where apparently there was a very popular Learn English textbook, And that was one of the first phrases you would learn in it, which is probably one of the most useless phrases there is, but it becomes a kind of shorthand for someone French learning English. And so this particular one, there's a kind of a logic of accumulation, and with them, the title remains in flux, even though the drawing is sort of fixed, it's framed, it's kind of done. This is one that's in the National Gallery's collection, and this is the current state of the title. It ran through a number of iterations, and Press Await was from the last time it was shown there, and it was sat next to a John Pollet Chuck sculpture, and Press Await was part of that title, so it stole it. But the drawing series has also allowed me to explore form in a more fluid way. I can do figurative works. I can do works that build on abstract patterns. It becomes almost like an open sketchbook. I can I use it as a kind of tool to give form to research at any time. They're quite big, and they do often make reference to, you know, high modernist or minimalist forms. And I've always made a point of never using high materials. I really do prefer minor materials, things like colored pencil, gouache, things that are more associated with hobbyists or the commercial arts. The most recent series was shown in Toronto last year, and it was a grouping that I'd made while in Paris, on a residency in Paris. And the format and the size remains the same. They're always the same size, and they always will be the same size. This particular set, though, delved, sort of pushed the series away from posters and more into the realm of books and book making. Over the years, after working in a bookstore, I also was a print production manager for a graphic design firm and ended up having to do a lot of press approvals. And so when you're printing a book, you, of course, you're not printing it a page at a time. They gang them up to do 16 pages on a single sheet. So when you go to do a press approval, it's quite, I always found it quite disorienting, because you would see a design that was very familiar because you were involved in proofreading it, checking it over, but because of the way that the works, that to make a sort of a set of 16 pages, they're all sort of separated so that when the sheets are folded up properly, bound and cropped, they land in the correct place. So the sheets are kind of all, the pages are all in the wrong order. There's also a lot of extra space because you fold the sheet and you crop the sheet. And so I always thought that there was a sort of potential there, because you could deploy a series of images together, which would be one side of this printer sheet. And it suggests that they were all pages in a book, but of course they're out of sequence. And then the context becomes something that one might or needs to imagine. And so the six drawings developed over this period of 4 months, often sort of starting with things observed. Like, while I was there, the European football soccer championship was on, and it was this sort of strange thing of lots of posters and ads of sort of athletic footballers, combined though with a lot of figurative nude classical sculpture in public space, and the two things kind of came together. And I started kind of collecting images. Power plant show was, the question was, why did I hang framed drawings on the wall when I really ought to have drawn directly on it? Which was probably true. And subsequently thought about this idea of drawing, making the drawings directly on the walls. The first one that I did was quite a large one. It's probably about 50 feet long. And it was a commission for the Agnes Hetherington Arts Centre in Kingston, Ontario. They have a in their lobby area, which often gets rented for functions, so their collection can't be displayed. So they started to commission works to appear on this overhead wall. And the drawing is called Problems That Arise from Continually Confusing Left and Right. It's a, you know, big drawing of an articulated folding ruler that flips between red and blue. And I've always been quite interested in the way that the colors of red and blue can kind of hold very different signification. How in the political spectrum here, the slightly more right-wing party is associated with blue, and something that moves slightly to the left is associated with red, whereas if you go south of the border, it's inverse. So these colors are capable to be both. And so the giant folding ruler became also a bit about confusing as well. I actually have no natural sense of left and right, and I have to hold up my hands like this for the letter L, which is really terrible for me giving directions, because I realize that I rely on other mnemonics, either this being the letter L, or when giving driving directions, I always associate the right-hand turn is the one where you don't have to cross traffic, and the left-hand turn is where you have to cross traffic, which was really bad when I was a navigator in the UK and everything was reversed, and so ended up getting quite lost. I think for this drawing too, it retained a lot of the qualities of the drawing series of, you know, that I've been doing before. The materials, it's like a minor material drawn on the wall. It also has a kind of sense of changeability. This composition is never fixed, and so the work exists in a, like the soloist, as a set of instructions. There's a template, and it can follow any compositional logic that a folding ruler can have. And so the institution is allowed to loan it. It can be redrawn, folded quite close on a wall, or in a very, very large gallery, it can be extended out almost to a straight line. And quite liked the kind of descaling, like being able to sort of pass on and allowing somebody else to do the drawing for me. The marks themselves are kind of, you know, they're quite simple. It's like coloring in, maybe with a bit of focus. This is a drawing of a bathroom mirror drawn directly on the wall using silver pencil crayon. And then just by kind of controlling the direction of these minor artless strokes, it does create a sort of semblance of reflectivity. A couple autumns ago, I also did a project in Oakville Galleries, just outside of Toronto, called A Piece of Glass, which filled an entire room as if a prism had been hanging in the window, sort of splitting rainbows across the space. And so for the exhibition here, I've done a new drawing commission for the gallery here called Seven Pages. And it's kind of part of both that and the presentation of my artist books. Both are about kind of communicating with the algorithm, particularly it's the Amazon.ca algorithm, the one that makes suggestions for you after you bought books. Over the years, I've been kind of quite fascinated with this and start inputting, it asks you questions, and you can actually say you own books that you don't just to see what it might predict. In a way, it's tried to become like what the bookseller used to do. And one of the things it also does is it automatically generates these quite hilarious graphics to give you a sense of scale and touch. And so for every book that's in its inventory, if you use Amazon.ca, click on the image and you'll be given something to kind of try to, you know, give you a semblance of touch. If the book is quite small, it'll appear with this graphic. If it's a little bit bigger, you'll receive the torso. Up to a while ago, if it was much bigger, the torso would lose an arm. Though recently, I think this might have been bothering people, they've substituted it with this new particular figure here. And I quite like this becomes like the subway poster on the platform. It becomes this chance to receive any kind of content. And for me then, it's a great opportunity to insert content into it. So for the show upstairs, we've inserted seven almost monochromes. But also, what does the Amazon.ca algorithm know other than the book you bought before or the book you bought after and what other people have done, which sometimes does reveal interesting things to you. But in the table presentations you'll see upstairs with all of my artist books there, I've created a short text that just tries to explain the strategies of artist books to the Amazon.ca algorithm to kind of give it a sense of how these strategies might be different or how it might miss the point. And so this sort of double dialogue with this computer program will appears in both of the projects upstairs. And I magically hit my 35 minutes exactly on, so.
Thank you, Derek.
Thanks.